I am in town and I just talked a bit about debugging mutators on Intel GPUs. First of all, to get a bit of understanding for the audience, please raise your hands if you use offloading for computation to some sort of device like co-processors or. Okay. And who's using GDB? Okay.
Sorry?
Like the Cesium 5, for example. The one you talked about. So this add-on card to the PCI Express bus, which I'm using the presence of. This is like a high performance computer. So, first of all, why would you offload stuff? Why would you do compute on the processor graphics? The first and foremost argument is quite easy to understand. Well, because it's there, it's already integrated on the die, so you get it basically for free. Second argument, the performance is booming. You can see on this graph, the fourth generation of the Intel Core CPU, the so-called Haswell, now we're like two generations further. Skylake was launched 2 days ago. And the performance keeps going up, which it's keeping the pace with the discrete class of GPUs. Third, it's a very parallel model, a highly threaded one. And last but not least, it has support for all the major computational APIs on the software side. It's a new it's an architecture on its own from a toolchain point of view. And before talking about debugging, I think you should probably understand it. So the basic unit is the hardware thread with its own set of registers. Basically two types, the general ones and the architecture specific ones. 128 GPRs, each 32 bytes in size. And they can be used for pretty much anything. And the architectural ones, stack pointer, programming counter, accumulators, and stuff that might change from a generation to the other. These threads get grouped into so-called execution units, which are basically one array of threads that share a number of functional units, because it's not the case that every thread has its ALUs and refetch and whatever functional units. A number of them share such units, but currently around 7. And they share the CMD FPU, the unit for accessing the memory, and the branching unit. Further up the scale, the EU's execution units get grouped into subslices that are not just an array of EUs that share level 1 and level 2 caches and a thread dispatcher. Subslices get grouped furthermore into slices, which are just like shared, more subslices are shared, bigger cache, the level 3 one. The advantages of this integrated debugging solution are like, first of all, you share all your physical memory with the CPU, so there's zero copy sharing of data between the CPU and the GPU. And starting with the 8th generation, which corresponds to the Broadwell CPUs, you can also share a virtual memory in the sense that you can pointer share. A virtual address on the CPU can be shared with on the GPU in the sense that the pointer is still valid there. Because Broadwell has already support for 64-bit addressing, so it's on par with the CPU. The instruction set, each instruction 32 bytes. Compact instructions allow for 16 bytes for one instruction. So base size instructions all the way. CMD controls flow for most of the instructions. In principle, you get like one program counter per CMD lane. have predication for most of the CPU execution. The best thing about that architecture probably is also that it's fully documented. You have the open source programming reference manuals and also developer guides, so all the commands that are really related to submitting tasks or shaders to the GPU are public, as well as was needed to actually use this, this ISA. And there are also open source tools which help in this area, and here it's worth mentioning the link to the GPU tool, it's already made in distributions. The supporting APIs that I mentioned on the first slide include pretty much everything that's on the market today, including the Intel Serif Plus, OpenFP, OpenGL, which is with its compute side of things, and OpenCL as well, and two APIs from Microsoft, the C++ and the DirectX one for the compute. I'm going to focus today on the Intel Serif Plus. What's important to mention is that the debugging solution is pretty much API agnostic, but I'm using the Serif Plus because it's very easy to understand. It's quite short from a code point of view. So it's supported by the latest Palo Studio XE. It allows for two models, synchronous and an asynchronous one. It's similar to OpenMP in some ways. The synchronous one based on pragmas and explicit declarations of memory pinning and so on. The Serif 4 is the building block for the parallel loop, and you, for a given array, you seem to have to specify that you're using them and their given lengths. This will get automatically picked up by the compiler and the library, and you just need the proper software and how to set up. That's all. For the asynchronous model, you have to know a bit more about how your device is working. You have a finer degree of control. You can enqueue shaders in a more flexible manner. And wait for them as you see fit. This is done automatically in the synchronous one, so you have a finer control in the synchronous one. But it's not so so user friendly. Just to explain a bit what's happening here, so you say that the Serif 4 is still the building block for it, implicit parallelism into it. But you have to explicitly declare that you are sharing memory with the GPU, that you are submitting some task to be executed on the GPU, and then that you are waiting for it to actually finish. So, the debugger and its architecture for this hardware. First of all, it's mainly, or it's just for now, remote scenario. So there's no local debugging for reasons that I'm going to mention later. So you have a development host and the target machine where you're actually doing the computations. On the host side, you have the GPU. And on the target side, you start with the GDB server retargeted for the processor graphics. You can see that the host app, which is the application containing this kind of offload or whatever other API, doesn't get to interact in any way with the GDB server. So what actually is happening is the following. GDB server links against the debugger support library or debugger library, which in turn communicates with the so-called debug driver. In this diagram, this is being depicted as being in the kernel space, but it's not necessarily the case for reasons I'm going to explain later. And these driver communicates directly with the hardware. You can see also data from the offload library, and it also needs data from the user remote driver and runtime libraries. So these two entities have to communicate with the debugger library for the GDB server and the NGDB to get a whole picture of what's being debugged. And of course, one of the most important aspects here is to have debug information. So once again, there's no communication between the GDB server and the host app. There's no communication here between the two drivers. And there's no extra requirement on the host side except for the GDB target for the service. So, what's with this GDB implementation? First of all, it's we have to define a new machine type at health level to specify that this is the architecture. The current port that we're shipping is based on GDB 7.6, and as I stressed on the previous slide, it's a port that's completely decoupled or completely unaware of the host app. So it's targeted only exclusively for that. It has absolutely no awareness of what's happening on the CPU side.
Can I just ask, you say disassemble via a proprietary library. How do you do that in the GDL?
Sorry, what's that?
Your last but one bullet.
Yeah.
You say you're disassembling using a proprietary library.
Yeah.
How do you do that in GDL code?
It's dynamic, it's linking it dynamically. And there are less locals of the whole thing, so this is where this is the direction. It's currently closed source for IP reasons, but we expect this to change, and we are pushing in that direction. So to make GDB fully aware, we provided XML descriptions for the general register files, for architectural register files, for the different revisions or versions of the hardware, the different generations. We currently support Haswell, Rotel, and Skylake. And because it's decoupled from the CPU side, there are no extra commands in GDB. So you don't need to learn any additional commands. This assembly is provided by the open source tool, the Intel GPU tools, or some additional proprietary like the one of the major restrictions for now is that it's only supporting the stuff that was in the model, so you don't get non-stop the same model for that. There are a number of challenges, and we had to count a number of challenges in porting this GDB to or retargeting GDB. First of all, we're not having a flat memory model. It's more like a segmented one because different types of addresses are mostly relative to some sort of base address. So you have to teach this kind of segmentation to GDB. The solution was to encode some kind of memory type in the upper bits of, or in the unused bits of the of a pointer or an address. Usability issue that can be easily solved was the large number of threads. The simplistic hardware that we support, which is the Haswell, let's say the desktop version, has at least around 150 hardware threads. So you can imagine how this will look like in a GDB console session. And the problem is that most threads in, let's say, casual scenarios might hit, let's say, breakpoint or whatever. Combine this with the standard board model, and it might get annoying for the or let's say how to follow. There were some changes required also at WRF level because the instruction set architecture allows for instructions that use indirection based on two registers. Linux side of things, there are some requirements at the kernel level. I mentioned here that there's this debug driver, right, which might not necessarily be in kernel space. For now, on Linux, we have it as a daemon in user space, because it has to be for now closed source for IP reasons. And because of this, the kernel has to be compiled without strict devmem filtering. So you have to allow user space to actually access RAM program. Furthermore, two requirements for the kernel mode driver, the IMM5, you have to disable the hang check timer via multi-parameter, and you also have to disable the hardware command course. There are two lines that you put in the etc mode probably. So that's easy compared to having the kernel with the logic disabled. One to do item for us is the implementation of support for all stacks. That's here in the progress.
What is the all stacks?
Well, normal back traces. I prepared a short demo to show you how this is actually working. So the machine that I'm using is an Apple or desktop machine running in stock in Ubuntu 15.04 with a specially compiled kernel which has this particular option disabled. So what would be the steps for debugging? First, let's take a look at the app. It's a very trivial app. It's using the most basic program for C++. No additional data attributes and one single cell for. The code is simply trying to find prime numbers by splitting an interval. And it, let's say, marks the first prime number that was found by a specific thread. So nothing complicated from the API point of view. Building for debug is, as you would expect, by the line chain disabling optimizations in the eventual compiler. So now to debug this, first we need to start that daemon I've been talking about, so this user space kind of driver. It starts with privileges, but it drops them after getting access to the required resources, so it's not a security risk. Then you have to start GDB server, that was the GDB server that was retargeted. And this is one of the things that might lead to discussions. There's no concept of right, if you're running on the GPU. So we're currently simulating it because we want to enable parallel debugging of different applications, right? You might have users So it needs to have the compiler libraries, the local libraries in the library path, as well as some libraries that are specific to the debugger itself, and then three more environment variables, which basically shape the debugger.
Seems to have failed to build a library.
Yes, and that's intended, because that library is actually a closed source binary, and there's a current open source project to have exactly. So it's about this piece here. There are ongoing efforts which are close to being finalized of having this open source. You can find it on GitHub. It's called CMITC for Media Runtime. So that we get rid of this part being closed source. So this is the GDB configured for the Intel Gen health target. Recall that we have to use remote debug. I have to explicitly load the binary, because there's no file that you can use, the host app and also library the whole thing on the fly. We cannot specify a file something. And all else gets generated on the relevant GPU overload gets generated on the fly. So in this example, there's not a very high thread count, because if you look at the source, you see that the number of iterations is quite low. And let's say we want to place a breakpoint line 29. We're there. Can you see that basically, as expected, all the threads are hitting the same breakpoint? We have a diagonal. And let's see the disassembly. Sorry for the formatting, it's because of the font size. So this is coming actually from the Intel GPU tool binary.
Yes. Different machines at the same time. I mean,
Yeah, but this would imply in this scenario having, as you say, different targets because it's one local target and one remote.
Well, that raises the question, why does it have to be a remote target? Why can't it just sort of be on the machine and not
it's just... Well, it will work in this case, but as I said, if your GUI is stuck.
Well, okay, so that also works because in that case you have just one remote machine. And you can do that with cell as well, so you can have a cell system. You have a remote target device with both the probability and the ASP side plus one single GPU sort of connection.
Yes. But it's also a different question, like as we see increasing the number of offload models, it might be the time to actually think about, let's say, a common infrastructure for offload debugging inside GDB.
Okay, I
mean, this is not extremely user friendly. Right? Let's say it would be really nice for the user to be able to just mount one GDB and GDB to be able to be smart enough to understand the or have some understanding of the underlying offload model and to provide help in that area. Probably OpenCL would be a candidate that.
So, and I'm saying we did that for the cell protocol.
Okay.
So we have, you could have a simple the main program, and as soon as it started offloading, GDB controls automatically to the right of the slot.
Was this upstream?
Yes, it's all
okay.
It works today if you have a cell.
Okay. Okay, so this would be it. It's going to close the presentation. Got any questions?
What is your plan in the master step? Do you push them upstream or?
Yes, we are working on opening things up. Because otherwise it should happen today. Three days. And this is where I would love to hear some feedback about. This is actually would be actually doable right now considering that the underlying library or the or not. One component at this time is closed source in this whole chain. So would upstreaming be a